Let's see. Okay, welcome to the first CADEP seminar in the, let's say, August-November semester. So today we have Ambrus, who is going to talk about multiplicative periods over, multiplicative periods of classical motives over function fields. Okay, Ambrus.
So thank you very much for the invitation. It's a great pleasure to be giving a talk at Rio de Janeiro, even if it's just virtual. So I don't really know how much you know about function field arithmetic. So I assume you don't know much. So I will start with some results, which actually not really the aim of this topic. But hopefully if I talk about these sort of things, then you will understand why I said what I said in the abstract. So it's a very well-known fact that if you take the ring of integers, or you take the rational function field in one variable over a finite field with q elements, assuming that q is a power of some prime number d, there is an extremely strong analogy. And this analogy starts with elementary things. These are both Dedekind domains. Oops, I should have written polynomial ring, not the function field. So it starts with both of these are principal ideal domains with the property that if you take an ideal which is non-zero, the quotient is finite. And it goes to extremely deep lengths, including things like the Laglance correspondence can be formulated over both of them. And there's been very interesting ways of one type of arithmetic influencing the other one. And so one of the things which is quite interesting and most people don't know about is that there is a very rich theory of transcendence over this ring and over its function field, which is just the rational function field in the same variable. So let's take the Lorentz series field in the variable 1 over t over this field. So this is just a power series when you allow finitely many non-negative coefficients. So I can denote this field by f infinity, while I denote the function field by f, because basically what this field is the completion with respect to the valuation the degree function, which is a valuation on the polynomial ring, which extends to naturally to a valuation on the rational function field, and this corresponds to the point at infinity on the projective line. So if you think of rational functions as rational functions on the projective line over the finite field, then there is a point at infinity, and if you look at the corresponding valuation and you complete the field, then you get this Lorentz series field. And so it's a non-Archimedean complete field, so it's mean about infinite series converging there. And so I can take A to be the polynomial ring. Let me fix notation. And I'm going to denote by A plus the subset of monic polynomials. So those where the leading term is 1. And so I can take n is an element of A plus the expression 1 over n to the k, where k is any non-negative natural number. So this series is going to converge even for the value k equals to 1, because this is non-Archimedean field, and you only need for an infinite series to converge is that the terms converge to 0. So this is going to give you some value, let's denote it by zeta of k, inside of f infinity. These are the so-called Karlitz zeta values. And they are very closely analogous to the zeta value studied by Euler. So you can ask about what are the transcendence properties of these values. So there is two easy relations. Well, one of them is very easy. The other one is not so much. So if you take any infinite series, n goes from 1 to infinity, but you can take such a countable set as A plus as well, and then you raise this p power, That's the same thing if you raise all terms to the p power and then you add them up. So this is a simple algebraic identity which holds in any field of characteristic p for finitely many terms, and then by a simple continuity argument you get that it's also true for infinite series. So you immediately get that this implies that if you take zeta of n times p times k, then this is zeta of k to the p for every k. So there is a more complicated relation. This is a theorem due to Karlitz from the 30s of the previous century. And it says that there is an element pi in F infinity such that zeta of k is p to the k divided by bk, where bk is something like a Bernoulli number. It's a non-zero element of FQT. In the case when k is congruent to one, congruent to zero modulo q minus one. And so this is an analog in the function field setting of Euler's relation, which expresses the usual zeta values for even integers. So in that case, what is q minus one? Q minus one is the cardinality of fq star, which is the same thing as a star. So it's just the number of units inside of this ring. And pi in the classical case is the usual period. Here it's something similar, although it's a bit more complicated to define. I will talk about this later. That you have these two relations. So this tells you is that there is an infinite sequence of integers where all the zeta values are algebraically dependent. And then there is a relation which relates k and pk. And then we have the following theorem, which is due to a Taiwanese mathematician, and Chang, another Taiwanese mathematician. I'm not sure there was another collaborator. I'm ashamed that I don't remember this now, although I should. And basically, their theorem is that there are no other relations. Over FQ bracket T. So this is a theorem which whose analog is a major conjecture in the transcendence theory over Q. And although we have some partial results, we know that the usual pi is transcendental. We are very far from proving anything like that. So the reason why this is possible there are several deep reasons, but one of them is that we can interpret the zeta values as some sort of periods of certain type of motifs, periods of something which are called t-motifs. And this is a very nice category. It's a much easier class of objects than usual motifs, which I'm going to refer to as classical motifs. These are basically vector bundles plus some sort of a Promedius semilinear map. And one of the crucial properties is that there is a very nice notion of tensor product in this category. And in fact, attacking this theorem, you basically prove that not just those k's which are congruent to zero, q minus one, can be interpreted as some sort of period, but all integer values for something called the Karlitz module, which already appeared in Karlitz's work. But its tensor products is something which was only defined something like 70 years later. So this is the sort of transcendence theory which I don't want to talk about that much. It's a very beautiful area of mathematics. And although I won't claim that everything is settled in this area, there are a lot of deep theorems which, for example, allow people to study transcendence questions about periods of these t-motifs. Okay, but then what sort of other transcendence theory is out there? Well, if you look at usual type of motifs or just an algebraic variety, like X is a projective algebraic variety, say smooth over, again, this field F u of t, or general something which is called the function field. So now we can assume that F is the function field of a smooth projective curve, irreducible a curve over the field FQ. So you can assume that instead of the rational things, it's even over F. Then it has a classically studied zeta function, but it is a rational function. It has coefficients in Q. And you can't expect that if you evaluate it in any kind of algebraic value, you're going to get a transcendental number. So you might naively think that there is no transcendental theory of periods for these objects, but that's not true. And the most important and classically known example is what's called the Tate period. So before I go on, let me ask, do I have an hour or I have an hour and a half?
Well, usually it is 55 minutes, but an hour just.
Okay. So I don't know how well you know this theory. Maybe you know it very well, but not for... So the Tate period is something like the analog of uniformization of elliptic curves over the complexes. So it's a uniformization. It comes from uniformization of elliptic curves over C. It's an analog of that more precisely, but over something like F infinity again. So what's F infinity in the general case? So F infinity is just going to be the completion of F at some valuation corresponding to some closed point C where F is the function of C. So it turns out that there is something like an analytical uniformization of elliptic curves over elliptic curves which are defined over F infinity, basically in the case when the J invariant of E, which is an element of F infinity, has a negative valuation. And what's the difference between this uniformization and the usual uniformization? So the usual uniformization, you take C and then you take a lattice inside. So this is going to be a Z module whose rank is 2, such that the quotient in the category of, say, complexly groups is actually compact. And then a classical theorem due to Weierstrass tells you that every elliptic curve over C as a Riemann surface is isomorphic to such a quotient. And then the periods of the elliptic curve are going to be a Z basis of this. They are not well defined, but kind of well defined enough. So such uniformization cannot exist in the positive characteristic case. Well, first we have to kind of try to make sense of what analytical means. So I'm going to tell you what the right definition is. So the right definition of what analytical is over F infinity is first, you take the algebraic closure of this field. There is a way to uniquely extend the valuation, and then you complete with respect to that. So I like to denote this field by C infinity. So this is both a complete and an algebraically closed non-Archimedean field. It's one possible analog of the complex field. There are others. So for example, you can take a much larger completion, which is called the spherical completion, and that will have much more elements than this form. So the fundamental problem with C infinity is that it's a totally disconnected space with respect to its natural topology. So you can't simply define holomorphic functions by requiring that they are can be expanded in Taylor series around every point, because then you will get a lot of functions which you don't want to be holomorphic, like locally constant functions. And there is just too many of these to get a kind of a useful theory of analytical theory of functions or something like holomorphic functions in this setting to be really useful for geometric purposes. So the big idea is that you take special domains in C infinity, which are called rationally connected. And so what does this mean? It means that D is the complement in the projective line over C infinity of finitely many things which you can call open disks. Like, let's call them DS. S is some finite set. S is an element of some finite set. So basically, DS is the image of the set. The absolute value of Z is strictly less than 1. Z is an element of C infinity under a Möbius transformation. Now, if you remember function theory, then you know that this is one way of defining open disks in the classical theory. But it turns out that, of course, this is the same set as either disk around infinity, which consists of sets of the form the absolute value of Z is bigger than some constant, or the absolute value of Z minus some center is less than some distance. So that's the two type of sets which you end up with. So you have a domain which is the complement of finitely many such domains, and you define something from D to C infinity to be holomorphic if it can be approximated by rational functions on the projective line over C infinity with poles in the complement of this domain in the projective line with respect to the supremum norm. It's easy to prove that these things are basically the same as some sort of generalized Lorentz series. So you can expand this series as a power series of in things like Z minus C, where C is some complementary point, raised to some power. And there is many ways to explain why this is the good definition. It's again analogous to a theorem in the classical theory. It's basically using the Weierstrass approximation theorem as a way of defining these functions. And then you don't have pathologies like locally constant functions anymore. And you can extend the definition of holomorphicity to more complicated domains in the following way. If C inside, let's use a different letter, if K inside of B1 of C infinity is compact, then a function from B1 of C infinity minus K to C infinity is holomorphic if it is holomorphic on every rational connected subdomain. If F restricted to D is holomorphic in the way defined above for every D inside of this domain, I don't know how to call it, omega, and D is rationally connected. So basically, it's a mixture of a local and a global definition. On certain test domains, you require that the function can be expressed in terms of Lorentz series, but otherwise you just require that these things kind of patch together. And that's basically the only difference. So instead of using only the open disks as test domains, you have to use slightly more complicated domains, and then you get a good notion of holomorphicity, which is good for algebraic geometry. And then you can start to talk about, okay, what does it mean to uniformize an elliptic curve? So maybe I state a theorem first. This is something like the analog of the Picard theorem. So let F from C infinity to C infinity be entire, which means is that it's a holomorphic function on the complement of the point at infinity, which is a compact set. So we know what this means, but of course it turns out that this is nothing else, just Taylor series which converge everywhere. If F is not surjective, then it follows that f is constant. So if you remember the classical Picard theorem, it says that if you have an entire function on C, which misses at least two values, then it is not constant. Here, it's even stronger. If it misses at least one value, then it is constant. So this shows you, for example, that there is no surjective map. So it follows from this result that there is no surjective map from C infinity to C infinity star, which is entire. So in some sense, you cannot have a holomorphic exponential. But the construction of the usual exponential function is still meaningful. So let's go back to the situation where f infinity was just the Lorentz series field in the variable 1 over t containing the rational function. And then A sits inside of f infinity, so I can consider f infinity as an A module. And then I can talk about a strongly discrete E lattice in f in C infinity. So I'm sorry, I can also talk about, inside of C infinity, that's also an A module because A is a subring of C infinity as well. It's basically a finitely generated and free A submodule such that for any open disk D, if I intersect it with this submodule, let's call it lambda, the set I get is finite. So this is slightly stronger than being discrete in the usual topological sense, but because this field is not locally compact, it turns out that that's the correct definition. And if you look at A inside of C infinity, it itself is an A lattice. I can multiply this with any value pi, which is non-zero. I'm still going to get a discrete A lattice. So I can look at what's called the Kurlitz exponential associated to this lambda. And it's defined by a very Ashdod's product. It's going to be Z, and then product. You take a non-zero element, little lambda of big lambda, and you take 1 over Z divided by lambda. And this is convergent. And because it's a limit of, it's absolutely convergent everywhere on C infinity, and because it's approximated by polynomials, this is actually an entire function. And so basically what turns out is that E lambda is actually a map from C infinity to C infinity, which is FQ linear. And this FQ linear map is actually lambda itself. So what it really does, it identifies C infinity divided out by lambda with C infinity. So that's one possible way of looking at uniformization in positive characteristic arithmetic. But what you get here, if you look at it as a group scheme, it's just the usual additive scheme. What's really new is the A multiplication.
Ambrus, I missed, what was lambda? Can you show?
So lambda is this thing which is called an A lattice. So it's a strongly discrete A lattice. So it's a finitely generated and free A submodule of C infinity. And the discreteness or strong discreteness that means is that if you intersect it with any disk, you get a finite set. This is the reason why this product is well defined, right? Because on any disk, it's actually going to have only finitely many zeros only. And just like in usual analysis on a disk, you can only have finitely many zeros. Okay. And so if you go back, this is an A submodule on C infinity. So there is a quotient A module structure on C infinity divided out by lambda. So basically what you get is that you get an A module structure on the additive group scheme. And so the big theorem of Drinfeld is, which was proved in a special case by Karlitz, that actually the new A module structure on the additive group scheme is algebraic. So I don't want to explain this in too much detail, but this means is that if you take an N element of A, and then you look at the N multiplication defined by this, so you look at the map which you define by, you know, taking an element Z in C infinity, you lift it to a Z tilde in C infinity under the uniformization. So this means that E lambda of Z tilde is Z, and then you take N times Z tilde, and then you apply the exponential. You can call this as phi lambda n of z. This is actually independent of the lift. This is a polynomial. Moreover, you can actually characterize all these polynomial A module structures on the additive group scheme. And if you take the easiest homomorphism, which is when phi lambda n is just okay, so basically what you have is that, so this is going to be an FQ linear polynomial. I'm already telling too much things about the Drinfeld module, so I have to stop myself soon, because this is not what I want to talk about. But anyway, if you take this, this is going to be something like an additive polynomial, an FQ linear polynomial. So it's going to look like a polynomial in Z to the powers of Q with some coefficients. Let's call this M, and then this is M as well. And basically, what you have is that this phi lambda defines a ring homomorphism from A into the endomorphisms of the additive group scheme over C infinity, which is the same thing as a skew polynomial ring in the variable Z to the Q. So it's a non-commutative ring, and this is a ring homomorphism. And because A in this case is FQ of T, such a homomorphism is uniquely determined by the value of T. And you can take the case when phi lambda of T is T plus this tau is Z to the Q, times C. This guy is called the Karlitz module. It's in some sense the simplest A module structure which can arise this way. And so the pi, which I mentioned at the beginning, this pi which appears in the Karlitz zeta values, in Karlitz's theorem here, pi is up to a unit in A is the element in C infinity, in fact F infinity, such that if lambda is pi times A, the resulting A module structure is the Karlitz module. And now you can see the analogy with the usual pi further, because what happens in the classical theory, there is an analytic uniformization of the multiplicative group scheme by the additive group scheme, which is the usual exponential. And if you look at the kernel of this uniformization, and then it's going to be generated by 2 pi I. And so this is the classical period, and in function field theorem arithmetic, if you look at the most basic kind of T motive is the Karlitz module, and its period is the one which gives you this uniformization. But all this discussion is an aside, because what I wanted to show you is that you can't expect uniformizations of kind of classical motives, at least you know, one-dimensional classical motifs like elliptic curves, although it depends what you think of motifs, but I like to think of elliptic curves as a concrete realization of the simplest type of motif, which comes from projective varieties. And so this result basically shows you is that this thing doesn't exist for elliptic curves. So you can't hope to have a uniformization by C infinity. And if you take the analogy of taking a lattice inside of C infinity, you're going to get some radically different objects, which are a priori A-module structures on the additive group scheme. So by the way, because the transcendence degree of C infinity over over the rational function field is infinite, you can have strongly discrete A lattices inside of C infinity of arbitrary rank. So in the classical theory, if you have a discrete Z module inside of C, then the rank of lambda is either one, and then you get the multiplicative group scheme and basically the periods of the multiplicative scheme, pi and its powers. And if you take the rank of lambda to be two, which is the maximal possible, then you get elliptic curves. Okay. So basically what happens instead is that you have an analytical uniformization, which is called the Tate uniformization, for certain types of elliptic curves, if you take C infinity minus the zero. So you can think of this as the analytical GM. And what does it mean that you uniformize an elliptic curve? Well, it means is that if you take any affine curve inside and you look at the pre-image, then you're basically going to get some sort of a domain inside of P1 infinity to which the theory applies, and the coordinate functions have to be holomorphic. And so the main theorem of Tate is, which is the starting point of rigid analysis, that if you are an elliptic curve over C infinity, then there exists such a Tate uniformization if and only if the J invariant of the elliptic curve has an absolute value bigger than one, which is the same thing is that the valuation, which is now not discrete, extended to C infinity, this is negative. So I was rushing a little bit, so I didn't explain what I want from this uniformization. Well, I want to have it most of the properties which we have in the usual one. So I want it to be a group homomorphism. I want its kernel to be a discrete lattice. And so this is when the situation gets radically different in the non-Hermitian case, is that there are discrete lattices of rank one inside of C infinity minus the zero. So if you take an element Q in C infinity such that its absolute value is not one, but you know you can switch by taking its inverse, you assume that its absolute value is strictly bigger than one, then you can take the integer powers of this element. So you look at the subgroup generated by Q inside of, you know, let's call it just C infinity star, the multiplicative group scheme over C infinity. And so this is discrete in any sense. This is a discrete Z lattice. And so we want that the group homomorphism has such a kernel. And Tate's theorem is that there is such a uniformization if and only if the J invariant has absolute value at least one. And moreover, the lattice is unique. Which basically means is that if you take this generator with the condition that its absolute value is bigger than one, this Q, which generates the lattice, which is an element of C infinity star, is an isomorphism invariant of the elliptic curve. So if you don't like this kind of holomorphic function approach, actually, there is a completely explicit description of what the uniformization is. If somebody gives you a lattice that you can write down what the, some sense, the Weierstrass functions are in an explicit power series, which is kind of universal. It works for any non-Archimedeanly valued field, so it actually has integer coefficients, and it's related to modular functions. So, oops, this is what happens when I... Okay, how can I stop this guy? I have to delete this. So this is the most basic example of what I call a multiplicative period. So why I insist on multiplicative? Well, I already mentioned that there is no exponential function in periodic analysis, but in positive characteristic, there are kind of very obvious ways to see that this cannot happen, because if you take infinity with its group structure, the additive group structure, then this is a p-torsion group. Well, if you look at infinity star, it's a non-torsion group. So you don't have analogues of the sort of things which people study in periods when you have any kind of logarithm appearing. And you basically can only expect to have a period if the definition in some sense doesn't involve a logarithm. That's one thing which you can learn from this informal discussion. The other thing is that you, if you want to have some kind of discrete lattice uniformization attached to your objects, then you also have to restrict on which sort of varieties you study. Like for elliptic curves, there is only certain elliptic curves which you have such a uniformization. Okay, but you could say that this is still not too much. Because it's a very simple, concrete example, although there is a transcendence result. It's proved by several people. I think it was proved by, I'm getting senile. So how is the Brazilian mathematician is called, famous number theorist who did transcendence theory?
There is a Paulo Ribeiro. There is a one in Brasilia. I
think he lived in the UK for a long time.
I don't know.
Goubert, maybe?
No, I think his name starts with V. I'm pretty sure he's Brazilian.
Okay.
Volok? Volok, yeah.
Exactly.
Felipe Volok. There are other people who prove this theorem again. You can censor me is that I don't remember. I think Takur gave a proof of this, but maybe Volok was the first one who proved it. So if you take an elliptic curve defined over, say, the rational function field, but you can state this more generally, and then its J invariant, its valuation with respect to the infinity I mentioned, is negative. This means it has a well-defined state period, which actually happens to lie in F infinity star, not just in C infinity star. And the theorem is that its J invariant and theta E are algebraically independent over FQT. So finally, we found something which is a period, and it is a transcendental thing. It's transcendental over FQT, for example, because the J invariant lies there. But this is kind of like an elegant way of stating a theorem without a reference to an explicitly chosen function field. And moreover, there is actually a theorem, which I think in its definite form is due to myself, but a slightly weaker form, basically using very similar methods, is due to Longhi and another mathematician whose name I forgot. I think this is Faraday the 13th, and the curse of Friday the 13th for me today is that I have serious difficulty remembering the name of my colleagues. So anyway, the theory means is that there is something like a Gauss type L value or special value which actually is equals to a rational number times this period. So I'm not going to explain this result because I'm going to state a theorem about a similar object, because so far this is almost all of the thing I told you is work of other people. But now I'm starting to talk about my work, but it's an old work, so I think it was published around 2008. Is that okay? But can you actually show any other multiplicative periods? And it turns out that there is. So if you stay with theta elliptic curves, so again, E is defined over F infinity or even C infinity, and it's J invariant, has absolute value bigger than one. It turns out that there is another way of defining periods which are multiplicative using the K2 of the elliptic curve. So the main theorem is that there exists a homomorphism from the K2 of the elliptic curve into C infinity star, which can be considered as a rigid analytic regulator. So let me explain the construction of this regulator. So what do I mean by K2 of E? So it's just going to be a Milnor K group. So what you do is that you take the function field of the elliptic curve, and then you tensor it with itself over Z. Or you almost, yes, you take the non-zero elements and you factor out by the usual Steinberg relation x tensor 1 minus x. So x is any element of I don't know how to denote this, maybe I should write as the C infinity of E. So the functions, algebraic functions on E. So the most basic invariant for such objects is, of course, what's called the tame symbol. So if you have a point on the elliptic curve, say at C infinity, then if you have such a symbol, so you have an X tensor Y in this tensor product, then you can look at the valuation attached to P on the function field, and you can make it to be the normalized one. So on a uniformizer, it's actually one. And so what you really do is that the tame symbol at the point P is, if I remember correctly, minus one to the valuation of X times the valuation of Y, and then you have something like X bar over Y bar, where what you do is that you fix a uniformizer T is an element such that P of T is one, and then you write X as X bar times T to the valuation of X, and you write Y as Y bar times the valuation of Y, or maybe I should write them as X tilde and Y tilde, I'm sorry. So X tilde and Y tilde are elements in C infinity of E, but they are integral with respect to P. So X bar is basically the class of X tilde modulo the maximal ideal of the valuation P in the function field. And so what you're going to get is that the valuation, the residue field is C infinity. So the tame symbol is actually turned out to be a non-zero element of C infinity. Okay. And so what is the theorem which constructs this? It's that let X and Y be holomorphic functions on the annulus, the absolute value of z is equals to 1, sitting inside of C infinity star. So then there exists a unique function from, well, I don't know, I'm going to write K2 of this annulus into C infinity star with the following properties. So the first thing is that if x and y are holomorphic on the annulus, and so how should I denote this regulator? I'm going to denote it by a bracket as well. And has a meromorphic extension inside the disk, the absolute value of z is strictly less than 1, then the regulator of x tensor y is just the product of the tame symbols of x and y at every p where the absolute value of p is less than 1. The second result is that this is continuous in both variables with respect to the supremum norm. So let me try to explain what this theorem really says and what's the logic behind it. So if you ever saw the like the most elementary non-classical example of period integrals, then one of them is the Bloch-Deligne-Bellingson regulator on elliptic curves or algebraic curves in general. And it has a lot of definitions. One of them involves logarithms, but it turns out that you can think of this regulator attached to an element of the Milnor K2 group of the function field of the elliptic curves, when you, you know, assume, for example, that all the tame symbols of the element is zero, as a vector bundle with an integrable connection. And such a thing has a monodromy on every closed loop. And because this is a rank one bundle, you're actually going to end up with an element of C star. And the usual regulator is the logarithm of this. You take the absolute value and then you take the logarithm and then you get a real number. But you don't have to do that. You're still going to get some complex valued functions attached to every loop. So what I want to do here is that I want to define a regulator where I imagine that I integrate on a loop in spite of the fact that there is no such thing as a loop here and there won't be a vector bundle with an integrable connection with this monodromy. And so the picture, some sense, is that actually you can also do something like a Tate uniformization in the complex case, because you know if you have a rank two lattice inside of C, first you can factor out by a saturated Z submodule, and then you get basically C star, and then you look at the image of lambda, let's call it lambda prime, and now this is a one rank module. So every elliptic curve using this argument over the complex numbers has a similar uniformization as the Tate uniformization. And so you can imagine is that your elliptic curve is uniformized by C star, and you can look at the image of the loop, which is the circle going around the zero of any radius. And the image of all of these loops in the classical theory are homotopy equivalent to each other. So the Bloch-Bellingson regulator takes the same value of them. But can I define this regulator in a different way? And so what happens is that you have something like a residue theorem for this regulator, which basically says that if you have finitely many poles of the holomorphic function, which gives you the symbol, and you take the regulators around the small loops, which goes around these poles, then you're just going to get. And on the other hand, you know, if you have a null homologue cycle, then the thing has to be zero. So you get something like a multiplicative form of a residue theorem for something like a multiplicatively valued integral. So all of this motivation is basically is that I want to define a regulator in this limited setting of theta elliptic curves in periodic analysis or non-Archimedean analysis, which is something like a multiplicative integral. So it's continuous, but it's going to take values in the multiplicative group, and in some sense also continuous in the multiplicative sense. And it turns out that if you require these two properties, this uniquely determines the function. This is quite easy, because if you take any two holomorphic functions, you can approximate them with rational ones. And for rational ones, you know what the value has to be, because it's given by the formula in the first condition. So by continuity, the function has to be unique. But on the other hand, you can also prove that such a regulator actually exists. So it's kind of very similar how you define integrals classically, is that you take a special class of functions when there is a closed formula, like step functions in Riemannian integration, and then you require that it extends on some kind of completion of the space, like with respect to the supremum norm, you take a Banach space continuously. It's just the only thing is that here you don't really have something like a Banach space or a Banach algebra. So you also have to be careful that if you really want to have all the good properties of this holomorphic function, you have to define it for different type of domains as well. And then if you look at rationally connected subdomains, they are always the complement of pairwise disjoint disks. You can imagine that every missing disk has a boundary circle. And so you can define a regulator for that boundary circle formally using the same definition. And then you say is that if you actually look at all domains, and you require that you have these two properties, then there is such a holomorphic, there is such a regulator for all functions, just for holomorphic functions, not for any element of the Milnor K group, with some additional functoriality property, and then you basically get a completely analytical result, which basically boils down in the end to estimating the absolute values of tame symbols of pairs of rational functions with certain properties of the locations of zeros and poles. So it's a completely classical construction. I discovered it myself, but later I realized that it's very closely related to a similar construction due to Kazuya Kato. In fact, it appeared in his higher class field theory for higher local fields. He needs such a construction to compute the Milnor K2 of higher local fields of dimension 2 in order to be able to prove his class theory result. It's essentially the same construction, and it's even related to another construction which was discovered by a mathematician called Contu Carrere. But he defined it in Porartinian rings, but all of these things are basically the same. And technically, the most flexible form of the construction is more or less the theorem I stated. So again, the way I like to imagine that this is some kind of a multiplicative integral on something like the circle z equals to 1 of some element in a K group, which you represent as a formal sum of symbols, and then you take an analytical domain on which all of these holomorphic functions are defined, and the circle you are taking is actually the complement of a boundary disk. The absolute value of z is strictly less than 1. And so if you want to extend this definition to elliptic curves, of course what you do is that you have your elliptic curve over C infinity. It has the Tate uniformization by C infinity star. And then you take an element, little k, in the k2 of the elliptic curve over C infinity. You can pull it back here, and then you compute this integral. And then you get a value C infinity. So in the end, what you get is a homomorphism from the Milnor k2 of an elliptic curve over C infinity into C infinity star. And that's what I call the rigid analytic regulator. So this is the thing which you can use to define an actual multiplicative period, which is not classical. So I'm approaching the end of my lecture, but I try to squeeze everything into the last minute. So if you take an elliptic curve over a rational function field or a function field of transcendence degree 1 over a finite field, and you assume is that E has split multiplicative reduction at infinity. This is almost the same thing as requiring that the J invariant has negative valuation at infinity. It's not quite. In fact, the condition of being split multiplicative is slightly stronger. But this allows us to have a Tate uniformization. So this means is that if I take the K2 of the elliptic curve over F, and then I map it by naturality into the K2 of the elliptic curve over C infinity, composing this map with the rigid analytic regulator, I get a C infinity here. Now, according to the function field analog of the Bellingson conjectures, there is a distinguished element here, which is well defined up to an integer rescaling, because you basically take an element which is from the motivic cohomology group of some regular model of the elliptic curve over the algebraic curve whose function field is f minus the fiber at infinity with weights 2. And conjecturally, this module should basically be Z plus a finite group. So there should be a distinguished element here. This is proved in some cases. Like it also follows in a large number of cases from my work when I proved a special value formula for this regulator. But the whole thing is much more nicely written up by Kondo and Yasuda in their paper on the subject, where they actually prove a stronger version, although the stronger version is an easy consequence of the weaker version and some simple arguments in using the tame symbols in motivic cohomology groups or K groups, depends on which perspective you like to take. So if you look at this distinguished element, it gives you a period here. In fact, it doesn't even matter if you choose any non-zero element, and because this is a homomorphism, you're basically going to get up to a rescaling in C infinity stars, so taking powers or roots, a distinguished element here. And so this is kind of another multiplicative period attached to a Tate elliptic curve at F infinity star. And as I said, I have a theorem which computes key E up to rational rescaling of a special value of a gross type zeta value under some technical conditions. So now let me state immediately a basic conjecture. So KE is transcendental. In fact, I can make the stronger conjecture. If I take FQ, then the transcendence degree of the J invariant of E, the Tate period of E, and this K of E is of degree 3. So there is no relations between the pre-basic periods. So I'm out of time, but what I'm trying to tell you is the following, is that there is a very interesting theory of periods of function of motifs over function fields of transcendence degree 1 over finite fields out there. This area is almost completely untouched. So other than some classical results, some transcendence results. For example, the theorem of Volokh is also known for abelian varieties with totally split multiplicative reduction. If you have such an abelian variety of dimension n, then it will have n Tate periods, and we know that these things are also transcendental. We have a way of trying to generalize this rigid analytic regulator for other motivic cohomology groups. But as you see, you have to assume something about the varieties. So personal speculation is you have to assume is that they have what's called totally degenerate reduction. The higher the dimension of the variety is going to be, the more transcendental periods it's going to have. And all of these are going to be related to zeta values. And basically some form of the Zagier-Koncevich conjecture is that motivic relations should predict transcendence or algebraic relations between these zeta values should exist. But as you can see, still at its infancy, so even this more modern period, which was defined and discovered by myself, we don't know that it's transcendental. And I talked to people in transcendence theory, and they said that it doesn't look obvious that this thing is transcendental. But I think, again, this problem is significantly easier than similar problems over number fields. And if you are not interested in transcendence theory, then there is this wide open problem of defining higher dimensional analogues of these regulators and at least formulate some kind of conjectural form of the Concevich-Zagier conjecture for these. With a theory which in some sense generalizes the picture which I explained you today. But I think I stop here. Thank you very much for the attention.
Okay, thank you, Ambrus. I think I will skip clapping. I don't know. In the online talk, to clap the hands seems a little bit strange. I don't know. Anyway, any question in the recorded session? If not, I will go to non-recorded session because I want to have a few questions. Just a moment.